free from the burden of sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There
is... Esther chapter 5. Now it came to pass on the third day, there's that third day again, that Esther put on her royal apparel. She dresses right. She's not going to walk in, you know, not dressed proper. And stood in the inner court of the king's house. All right, she's not in the throne room. But she's in the king's house, the inside. Over against the king's house. And the king sat on his royal throne in the royal house. Over against the gate of the house. All right, she's in the, they're both in the same house. He's in one room and she's in another room. And it was so when the king saw Esther the queen standing in the court. She made it that she can be seen, but didn't make it look like she wanted to be seen. You get what I'm trying to say? Because she just couldn't walk into the king's throne room. And if he didn't hold out that golden scepter, she'd be dead. And you got to wonder, it's not told what condition she is. Is she relying on God, like just wait for God to do something? Is she sweating? Is her heartbeat going crazy? Will he want to see me or will I lose my life? We're not told. And wonder how we act when God puts us in things that God's in complete control. Remember, God is not mentioned in the book, but God is in the book. He's in this chapter. I think if God would not have been in chapter 5, I think Esther would have been dead. Because there would have been no reason for her and no reason for the king to accept her. If the law was that if you were not called. Well, she wasn't called. And there are some things that where man's laws goes against God, you got to do what God tells you to do, and then you got to suffer the consequences. But there's a very thin line there. That she obtained favor in his sight. So she made herself be seen. And God turned the eyeballs on the king and said, hey, there's your wife. A lot different from Eve and the serpent in Genesis chapter 3, where her eyes were on something that wasn't supposed to be so. Where Satan worked on Eve's eyeballs and God's working on the king's eyeballs. And the king held out to Esther the golden scepter that was in his hand. Well, that's interesting. It's his wife. But here she doesn't have a throne. She has no seat in the throne room, the royal throne of the royal house. Even the queen needs permission to come in. By holding out that scepter, her life was been spared. God is involved in this woman's life now. Now she can work. Now all the prayer and fastings and the sackcloth and the ashes, all that, God is answering prayer. So Esther drew near and touched the top of the scepter. It's been accepted according to chapter 4, verse 11. She's been approved. Then said the king unto her, what wilt thou, Queen Esther? And what is thy request? It shall be given thee to half of the kingdom. Well, half the kingdom, you can't, she can't walk in there and say, hey, I want the whole kingdom. That's what American woman does with divorce today. I want it all. And that's where a man gets his claws in there before he gets married. Hey, listen, you can't take it all. It's in the Bible, 16:11. He throws that request in. Listen, Herod does that to his dancing, belly dancing daughter. I'll give you half of the kingdom, whatever it is, just ask. Even half the kingdom is still half of a rubber check. But then again, you're working with royalty here. The king has power. There are no people in the world today that have power. In order for somebody in a world nation to do something, he's got to have 45,000 people to back up what he's going to do. Only ones that really, really have power today is the dictators or those people that overthrow the governments down south, South America. But then somebody overthrows them and kills them and that kind of thing. But he comes to her and asks her for a request. Where did that come from? Maybe she just wanted to come walk and see her husband. But there is a request. And God is using his mouth to speak and say, okay, Esther, what do you want? Now, she uses a little wisdom, which I don't understand, because she could just say, listen, my people are in trouble. Here's the letter. Do something. But she doesn't. She makes out two banquets. Now we know that God's already hanging Haman. But why these two banquets are made, I don't know. But she answered, or Esther answered, said, if it seemed good unto the king, let the king and Haman come this day unto the banquet that I have prepared for him. Now who's the him? Is it the king or is it Haman? She's already prepared a banquet. If she's already prepared a banquet, then she's got some faith that God was going to do something. Or maybe she's got to go hurry up and go make a banquet now. But if this banquet's already prepared, she's had faith in God. She's already got it thought out in her head by prayer and fastings and supplications and sackcloth and ashes and everybody praying for her. But who's to him? Probably Haman. Then the king said, cause Haman to make haste, that he may do as Esther has said. So the king and Haman came to the banquet that Esther had prepared. All right, here they are, three people. Artaxerxes, Haman, and Esther. The Jew hater, the Jew, and a guy who's a type of God. Now this book is tribulation. Where's the Gentiles? Where's the Gentiles in that passage? They're not there. It's a time of Jacob's trouble. And the king said unto Esther at the banquet of wine, what is thy petition? Well, I don't remember her ever asking for anything. The dinner's done and all that, and he's like, okay, well, what's thy petition? Something else. What happened at the first banquet? And shall be granted thee, what is thy request? Even to the half of the kingdom shall be performed. Wherever it spoke about that. Then answered Esther and said, my petition, my request is, if I have found favor in the sight of the king, if it please the king to grant my petition and to perform my requests, let the king and Haman come to the banquet that I shall prepare for them. Well, we had a him, now we have them. Now we're getting more and more deep into this thing that's going to happen in Esther. Was for him, now it's for them. And I will do tomorrow as the king has said. So in 24 hours, it's going to be another banquet between the king and Haman himself. Getting Haman a little high in the britches here. Then went Haman forth that day joyful with a glad heart. But when Haman saw Mordecai in the king's gate, that he stood not up, nor moved for him, he was full of indignation. Indignation is not just anger, fierce anger. Listen, God has indignation against those that won't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. God has indignation against the Jews that did not believe the Messiah. God has indignation against Jews that didn't obey the law. Well, guess what? Guess who has indignation against the Jews? The Antichrist. Haman. Against Mordecai. Nevertheless, Haman refrained himself. Look at those words. Refrain means to held back. Isn't that an interesting word that he put in there? By the Holy Spirit. He was going to do something right then and there, and he backed off. And when he came home, he sent and called for his friends and Zeresh, his wife. And Haman told them of the glory of his riches. Hezekiah did that. When Babylon came, look at everything I got. So that money that he promised back here in chapter 3, he was able to pay because he's got riches. He's a very rich man. You know how rich the Antichrist is going to be? He's got everything that Walmart would want to have. And all you do is go through the 666. Read over here Revelation of all the merchandise that he has. And it has to be bought through him. Or his agency. One World Government. He told Jesus, he says, listen, I have all the power of the earth. And Jesus did not rebuke him. Problem is, all his riches and all that's going to burn up, Peter tells us. With a fervent heat, the elements shall melt. And the multitude of his children. He's got a lot of children. And all the things wherein the king had promoted him. He got a promotion. He got so promoted that the king allowed people at the gate, at the king's gate, to worship this guy. Or reverence, as we talked about. And how he had advanced him above the princes and the servants of the king. Looks like he's second to the king. He's got pride. He's got lust of the flesh. Look at all my riches. Look at all my children. He's got lust of the eyes. See what I have? See everything going on? See all my gold? See all my silver? See all my children? He's got the pride of life. Look at me. Look who I am in this kingdom. Now you know he's bound for the fall. You know he's going to be destroyed. You know pride is not of God. And you know this is all Satan's going to have. This is three things. These are only three tactics that Satan uses. And nothing more. Pride of life, lust of the eyes, and then lust of the flesh. Those are the three basics of sin, and Haman's got all three of them. in one verse, in one meeting with his friends. We're not talking about, you know, on Friday night he's a boozer, Saturday morning he's a drugger, Sunday morning, you know. In one event with all his friends and his wife and his family, he's got all three sins. Sound like Belshazzar when he had his great party with all the gods of wood and stone and all that. Oh, here, Daniel, take it. My kingdom's not going to fall. See all this stuff I got? Look at everything I got. Haman said, moreover, yea, Esther the queen did let no man come in with the king unto the banquet that she had prepared, but myself. There's only the three of them. I got to sit with the royalty. He's boasting. That's why he called all his friends. Look at me. Look at that. Look where you weren't. And tomorrow am I invited unto her also with the king. I'm going back tomorrow, not you guys. Ha ha. I'm somebody. Pat me on the back, please. Everyone ready? 1, 2, 3, fall down. Worship me, myself, and I. Come on now. Come on, children. You didn't bow down all the way to the ground. He's got position, he's got riches, he's got children, he's got a wife that looks like she stands by his side. He's got all these friends, he's got this, he's somebody in the kingdom, and you think he'd be happy. Oh, if I win the lottery, I'll be happy and this and that. No. Says Lord Haman, with all that, yet all this availeth me nothing. You mean the riches are nothing? Your children are nothing? Your friend is nothing? Your wife is nothing? Your job is nothing? Wow, you miserable wretch, you unthankful idiot. He just said everything that he just talked about, everything he just had pride in, everything he was boasting about, that's nothing. If I was his wife, I'd be insulted. If I was his children, I'd be insulted. That's nothing. You know, the Antichrist is going to have this entire earth like he wants, entire world like he wants. He's going to have everybody practically falling down before him, everybody receiving his mark, everybody worshiping his image. The whole world, he's got exactly what he wants. Matthew chapter 4, Mark chapter 4, I believe it is. Where he told Jesus, he said, fall down and worship me. He's got the world doing it. You think Satan's happy? You think Satan's going to be happy in the tribulation period? Look what happens. So long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. Notice how he said Jew. You know one, listen, I can prophesy, I got the word of God, I'm a preacher, I'm a teacher, I got the King James 1611 Bible. You know what I know? That all these fortune tellers and the horoscope people and all them that read tea leaves, paint your palm red and all that. You know what I know? I know what's going to anger the Antichrist. Jews. Imagine that. You know, there's a kid's story out there. You got this lion. I mean, he is the king of the beast. He can attack whatever he wants. He can get whatever meat he wants. He's got a pride full of female lions and little cubs or whatever they call them. And he had a little sliver in his paw. He's the king of the beast. Well, he had one little sliver. And no one could get that sliver out. Well, the sliver here is the Jews. And to top it off, they are the God's people. The one that he hates. The one that he wants to take his throne. And he's angry that the Jew, and it says Mordecai the Jew. So when he calls that time for that image to speak and everyone to fall down, the Bible says in Revelation, and when the Jews don't do it, he's going to get angry. You don't believe me? You think I'm full of it? You think I'm lying to you? What happened to Nebuchadnezzar when they, when the three Hebrew young men did not fall down and worship the image? Didn't it say he got angry and that he fired up that furnace seven times more? That seemed angry to me. That he didn't care that some of his servants were killed when they put the three boys in? Scripture is scripture. You got the story. You know what's going to happen. Now let me ask you a question. Aren't you glad as a saved person you're not going to see the wrath of Satan? That's why we witness, why we tell people about Jesus Christ. Listen, if Jesus Christ were to come tonight, the next power is not going to be a Republican, it's not going to be a Democrat, it's going to be the Antichrist. And Gentiles and Jews will suffer under him. Now, when Jesus said that I'm going to separate the sheep and the goats, well, the sheep are the ones that help the Jews. You can't take that story little. Oh, yeah, here you go. Brown, take some food here. You know, you go down to the hospital. There's a Jew in there. He's been, you know, captured by the troops and all that, shot. And, you know, you take care of his wounds. You go down to the city hall and in the jail there where the Jews are, you go visit them. Really? You mean when Haman's angry? He's furious? He's got indignation with those Jews, and you're just going to walk down there and take care of those Jews? You're putting your life on the line. And you're going to see that in Esther. There are people that help the Jews. There are people that turn Jews. As long as I see sitting at the king's gate, then Zeresh, his wife, and all his friends unto him. Now, we don't know who said this. It's the wife and the friends together, but this she ranks up there with Job's wife. Curse God and die. Look what they say. Let gallows be made of 50 cubits high. That's 75 feet approximate. If you were to take two full school buses and stand them on end, that's how high these gallows would be. Now, this was not something that he did privately in his home, okay? The entire neighborhood knows that he's building these gallows. And he builds them in one night. While the entire neighborhood's trying to sleep, you're hearing, neighbors, come on, Haman, trying to go to bed, knock it off. Stupid moron, I got work to do. Now the Euphrates, you're over there building a stupid thing over there. Turn off that light, you moron. And he's got the hammers going, he's got the screws going, he's got the workmen going. He runs down to Lowell's and says, open up the gate, I need some wood. So you got to read the Bible. You just can't say, okay, I'm done. This guy's doing it in the middle of the night, keeping the neighbors awake. And then imagine, you know, the neighborhood, everybody wakes up in the morning, cock-a-doodle-doo, and they get out their camels, start up their camel, and look up, what the heck is that? What on earth? That wasn't there last night, was it? No, it wasn't. I walked the dog last night. That wasn't out there last night. Where was that? Ooh, Haman's got, he's mad at somebody. Somebody got to hang. And tomorrow speak thou unto the king that Mordecai may be hanged thereon. 75 feet for a short Jew person. Say a Jew, 5 foot, 6 foot. 70 extra feet just for a Jew. One man. I tell you, he's angry. And go thou in merrily. You want to kill somebody, go, hey, I got the murder down in my heart. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Going to kill Mordecai. Yay. I'm going to a party. You're not going. Ha ha. Probably as he's walking down the street, he turns around, looks, yep, that looks good to me. Can't wait to see Mordecai hanging from that thing. This guy's wicked. This guy is rebellious. With the king onto the banquet. Only thing he can think about now is going to eat. And the thing pleased Haman, and he caused the gallows to be made. What a way to end our chapter. Queen Esther walks into the throne. She's, if he holds out the golden scepter, okay, I'm received. If not, I'm dead. Okay, I made a dinner. We sit down, we have a dinner. I'm going to have another dinner. The dinner's over. Plans are made for tomorrow. Everybody walks out. He steps out to the king's gate. Mordecai angers him. He goes home, gets everybody gay, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, all right. That ain't nothing. I want that guy dead. And the family said, hey, build a gallows. There we go. Don't you just love the Bible? By the way, you do know what chapter it is. It's chapter 5. 5 in your Bible is death. Esther may have died in this chapter. He said that Haman refrained himself in verse 10. Mordecai might have died in this chapter. 10. 5 times 2. And then his wife and family come, build gallows. Gallows is only for one thing. Babylon had the hanging gardens. Haman has the hanging Jews. Daniel, we are seeing history, and we are reading prophecy. We're talking about, this is a guy, he's like Adolf Hitler. Read about Adolf Hitler. Read about what the SS camp did to the Jews and all that. That's coming back. I'm telling you right now. Gallows are coming back. What's it say over about Revelation? He said that those that have been what? Have been beheaded. Mordecai would have hung by his neck. John the Baptist was beheaded. Capital punishment is coming back. Capital punishment for not obeying the Antichrist. Now, what do you think the world's going to do for the Jews? When a Jew stands up there to be at the guillotine. Listen, today, those who are guilty, he needs to get off. He needs to get off. You get a Christian or somebody like Jesus Christ, crucify him. It's a wonderful book, the Bible, because the Bible tells the truth. Bible was scripture with scripture. God put it there. He says, to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. How did you know that you had King Nebuchadnezzar get angry because of an idol. By the way, what were those three boys? They were Jews. What was Daniel? A Jew. What did he get caught? Praying. Where did he get thrown to? A lion. Who is the lion in the Bible? Ah, ha, 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 ha. Satan. You did catch that. You did get that, right? Daniel was thrown to the devil. And we conclude there.